be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold, pure gold. Refiner's fire. My heart's one desire is to be.
God, we exalt your name high above every other name, and we place you at the highest place right now, right here in this place, oh God. Sing Refiner's Fire.
Refiner's Fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be.
That is our prayer here today, that as we come together in the name, Lord, we will, in your name, we will be united, Lord, in your love, in thought, and in deed, Lord, and we can come together and celebrate, Lord, your goodness and worship you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Who God is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes?
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder?
The King of glory,
the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.
That you would take my place.
That you you will bear my cross. You lay down my life that I would be set free. Oh, oh Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Oh Lord, oh thank you Jesus for what you have done. Let's declare it.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice,
shines like the sun in
all in his brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
You lay down your love. You've done for me.
Oh, we sing for that. We sing worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Jesus.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace.
This is something
that you would take my place. You've done for me.
Whoa,
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen.
My life is yours, and my hope is in you. Only in my heart you hold, 'cause you made this sinner holy and holy, holy. Your glory is so beautiful. I fall into my knees in awe. And the heartbeat of my life is to worship in your light. 'Cause your glory is so beautiful. Your glory is so beautiful.
Come on, lift your voices. My life.
My life is yours. And my hope is in you only.
Our hearts.
And our hearts.
glory.
Cause your glory is so beautiful. I fall into my knees in awe. And the heartbeat of my life is to worship in your light. Cause your glory is so beautiful. Your glory is so beautiful.
Let's all rise for the reading of God's word. Our reading is from the book of Mark, chapter 7, verses 1 to 23. Clean and unclean. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus and saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were unclean, that is, unwashed. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash, and they observe many other traditions, such as washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. So the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with unclean hands?" He replied, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about your hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men.' You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to the traditions of men." And he said to them, "You have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother, and anyone who curses his father or mother must be put to death. But you say that if a man says to his father or mother, whatever help you might otherwise have received from me is korban, that is a gift devoted to God, then you no longer let him do anything for his father or mother. Thus you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and you do many things like that." Again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a man can make him unclean by going into him. Rather, it is what comes out of a man that makes him unclean." After he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. "Are you so dull?" he asked. "Don't you see that nothing that enters a man from the outside can make him unclean? For it doesn't go into his heart, but into his stomach and then out of his body." In saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean. He went on, "What comes out of a man is what makes him unclean. For from within, out of man's hearts, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and make a man unclean." May the Lord bless the reading of his word. You may be seated.
Thank you, Sister Hazel. Good morning. The reading of God's word this morning is lengthy, I know, but it's also borders on being a negative one. But let me assure you that there are positives in there. There are positives in terms of other passages that parallel this one. As you know, there are four Gospels, and we're studying Mark, but from time to time we mention the other books of Luke, Matthew, and John. Mark being the shortest of the Gospels is why we take this up in our sermon. But listen very carefully to this challenge before us. And if you all look up and see this, what's on the screen, it says, "How can we change from the evil within us?" How can we change from what we see is an evil heart within us? Now, some of you may not agree fully with that statement. What, me? Having an evil heart? And then, why do I need to change? Now, these are questions I want to put forward to you today. I was watching an episode of Celia's favorite shows. One of them is Criminal Minds, no?
How many of you watch Criminal Minds from time to time? How many of you, like me, don't like watching Criminal Minds? Okay. I don't like watching it because it's a very gruesome TV series. I'm missing Celia, so that's one way I get in touch with her, by watching the shows that she likes. And the other one, of course, Blue Bloods. But that's less gruesome. There's one episode, and listen to this story because it's interesting. I forget what the story is about, but I remember the ending. The ending went like this. I'm not familiar with all the characters. And you can help me with this. Who's the guy who's supposed to be the smartest of them all? The guy who's like a consultant. Older guy. And who? Now, Reed is a younger guy. Older than Reed. Sorry? Hutch? Rossi. Yeah, Rossi. Okay, Rossi. Let's see. Let me try to recall the story. I'm just doing it off my head, but I did write some notes. Rossi was asked by the boss. What's the boss's name? Hutch. The boss, Hutch. Hutch goes, "So with all these things that are happening, don't you think there's evil in this world? Don't you think there's evil in this world?" And the African-American guy, the one with a head like mine, what's his name? Morgan. Morgan goes, "Oh, it's all part of brain chemistry." He goes, "It's all part of what goes on with the synapses and the brain chemistry. This causes all this evil in the world." And Rossi goes, the smartest guy says, "I don't think so. I think with all this evil in the world, we have it in us to be evil." Rossi says that. And this boss says, "But I don't know. It could be any number of things, but we know it's there, the evil around us." Do you agree that there's evil around us? And there's evil within us. There's evil within us. And if you don't believe that, just observe a newborn little child when he comes out of this world. Nothing could be purer, right? Give it a few months, maybe a year. Maybe a year, and you will see. If you never had children, you wouldn't know. But those of us who had children, not that I'm saying my children are bad, no. I'm just saying that it happens to be so natural. Let me tell you about my grandchild, my newest one, Judah. No? Of course, very innocent, cooing and beginning to smile, right? Wonderful experiences. But his older brother, Theo, is beginning to feel insecure. He pushes him aside and sometimes kicks him. Now, where did he get that? Where did he get that kind of behavior? He doesn't see anyone in his family doing that, let alone to a baby girl, a baby boy. So they're very careful with him. They keep an eye on him. But who's to keep an eye on us? I struggle with this passage because I know that deep within my heart, I'm as capable as anybody else of evil. What? You're a pastor and you say you're capable of evil? Yes, I am. Because in our verse this morning, in our passage this morning, Jesus has this, I'm sorry, it's a bit small. Can you read it? But if you don't have it, you can't see it, open your Bible to verse 21 to 23. And I'll read it for you. And many times Jesus repeats these words, but you should pay attention to the context of it. I'll say to you what the context of it first. For from within, that means out of the heart, comes what? Evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. It makes a person unclean. What makes you and I unclean is the evil within. It doesn't come from the unclean things we see around us. It doesn't come from the unclean things that we are sometimes, experiencing or sometimes forced to do. Yes? Why is that passage so important? Because the passage talks about how the Pharisees, and you know who the Pharisees are, they're religious leaders, very well taught the Bible, the law, I mean the Old Testament, that is. And yet, they are wrong. Jesus said, you religious leaders, you who think you know the Bible or the Old Testament, are wrong. Wait a minute. How can somebody who is so good at the Bible, good at the Old Testament, be wrong? You would expect someone who has a very good knowledge of the Word of God will be right. Why? Because he says they have robbed the law of its purpose. And what is the law? Law of Ten Commandments. Jesus mentions the different commandments of God in the whole of the New Testament. Let me test you, okay? Especially young people, let me test you. Can you recite the Ten Commandments by heart? What is the fifth commandment? Okay, so you notice I already jumped to the middle. What is the fifth commandment? Okay, those of you who are older, the young people have no answer. Okay, somebody has an answer. What is it? Honor your father and your mother. It doesn't stop there, does it? What does it say? For it comes with a... Okay, sing it for us. How does it go? Okay. That's the first half of the commandment. Okay, help her, those of you who know the commandment. How does it go? Sorry? That your days may be long. Does that mean if you don't honor your father, you will die quickly? You might. No? It's a promise, but it doesn't say the negative. Does it? You look at the positive, because you always look at the negative, right? Oh, if you don't honor your father and your mother, you will die very soon. Or your life will not be long. But look at the positive. It says, if you honor your father and mother, your days will be long. Do you follow it? You live longer. Do you realize that, young people? You will live longer. Why? Because if you honor your father and mother, they will be living a life of peace and their days will be longer. And if their days are longer, yours too will be longer. I mean, that's my own philosophy there. But, the Jews or the Pharisees had a way of replacing that with human tradition. What's the human tradition? Korban, it mentions. What does it mean? Just look at the passage. Well, just so you don't lose track of this, the Pharisees were criticizing the apostles, Jesus, because his followers don't wash their hands before eating bread. How many of you wash your hands before eating? Okay, how many times do you wash your hands? A lot of us wash our hands, like me, we're OCD. We wash our hands so many times because we're not sure it's thoroughly clean. But the point is this, that's nowhere in the Bible. That's nowhere in the Old Testament law. It's in what is called the Mishnah. Now, let me tell you a bit more about the Mishnah. The Old Testament laws were given to Moses and the Israelites because they were a state that is, a theocratic state. One that has God as their leader, so they had to form these laws, right? But the laws were not specific on things like korban, things like eating with defiled hands. And if you ever go to Israel and watch all and look at all these relics, no, these ancient buildings and houses, you always find a misbahot. What's a misbahot? It's a small bathtub. There's a bathtub in every Jewish household. Why? When they go to the market, after coming from the market, like this verse says, no, what do? They wash. The word for wash in the Greek is baptizo, which is like where you get the word baptism. They dip themselves into the tub. Make sense? Okay, so three different things that are discussed here. The korban. Let me bring this out. The korban, washing of hands before eating bread, and washing, baptizo, in a small bath. Now, that's just the background, okay? Because these are human traditions, these are rules in the Mishnah. The Mishnah is an interpretation of the Torah, the Old Testament commandments. You go to Manhattan and go to any Jewish community there or to Brooklyn, and you see that they apply all of these rules that they have. In fact, if you go come across somebody, as I was walking through Brooklyn one time, and I said, just very simply, I wanted to read the sign that said something was saying in Hebrew, but I couldn't read it. So I asked him, "Can you tell me what that sign says?" With a black hat and curly hair, and he didn't want to talk to me. Now, he didn't want to talk to me. So I tried the next man, the next younger gentleman. And because he's younger, he explained to me, that's a grocery store. Okay? What does that say? See, all of these rules, listen very carefully, are in place because they don't want to be contaminated by unclean people, by unclean things. Things like even a woman's menstruation or a dead body, a dead animal. When you touch it, you have to do a certain ritual. Why? Because they think that they are clean. And Gentiles like me talking to them, unclean, unclean. In the Old Testament, lepers belong to the same category, and women who are going through their cycle. In fact, they've gone to so much extreme that some of these Jewish sects, as in S-E-C-T-S, won't even talk to a woman of their own kind. Now, you wonder, what's the whole point of this? Like I said, the Pharisees robbed the law of its purpose, and the purpose of the law is to point out your sin. Not to prove that you are less a sinner than somebody else. That should lead you to repentance and faith in God. And when you have faith in God, God's judgment on you for being evil becomes a way for you to experience God's grace of forgiveness. Look at it this way, in the modern times, no? In your office, if somebody gets fired, right there and then, do you come up to him and say, "I'm sorry you're losing your job"? What does everybody do? Right there and then, when somebody gets fired, No one talks to him, right? Everybody withdraws. Why? He don't want to be associated with that guy who just got fired. Why? Because you might be next. They might think you're in connivance with him, with something he did wrong. You might think, I'm going to get contaminated by this guy. Do you follow? This is what it means by defiled, being defiled. So the disciples are not washing their hands before eating, and you're a Pharisee, you don't want to be part of that disciples of Jesus. Because if I do that, I will get defiled. I'll be considered as somebody that God doesn't like. Do you follow? Make sense? Okay, now that you understand that, here's the point. You see, all of these human traditions, by the way, question, do you think we still have those same traditions in the church? Some of you are nodding. Some of you don't want to commit yourself. Let's just suppose somebody comes in here wearing an earring and is not female. Okay? I was thinking of doing that sometime, but I don't know how you'd like it. I don't even want to have an earring because it's a big bother for me, but it's a nice decoration, isn't it, don't you think? Or a woman with a nose ring. What do you call the one that you put in your eyelids, like, or your eyebrow, or your cheeks, or all parts of your body? What will you do if somebody comes into the church with that kind of appearance? Do you go, unclean, 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 let him sit by himself? Or even a tattoo, a mohawk, struggles to get to their seat because he's having some convulsions or whatever, saliva coming out of his mouth. How do we feel about those things? I once went to a church back in the Philippines, and we went out to a place for the aged, but at the same time, this home for the aged also had people with physical disabilities. Abunjo is one such person who has one leg. His pants is folded on one side. He had a crutch there, and he walked like this, right? And he went to our church after our activity at the home for the aged. No one talked to him. No one wanted to even come close to him because he smelled. He's not very much washed, and he's actually always asking for money. You see, we have kept the traditions of men ourselves, what we consider to be good and upright in a person. You're going to a church and you're wearing shorts? If you're wearing anything at all that reveals half your body? Or even in Australia where they wear slippers in church? Or no slippers, barefoot? Dirty feet. They've just been to the beach. Beach culture in Australia is quite strong, right? What do you do? I'm giving you all of this because that's similar to that situation. Our society has defined what is upright, what is acceptable, and yet these rituals and customs do not replace the intents of our heart. What's in our heart remains the same. It's still evil. You see, to change the human heart, these customs and traditions will not work. This will not work to change the human heart. Do you understand that? Nothing that we put in place by way of practices will ever change the evil in your heart. Do you believe that? So why do we come here? When we do mostly rituals, we sing songs, We do this, communion. We do this, baptism. But then you go home and nothing's changed. After a few months or years of doing this, and you realize it's just another church activity. I don't want to go there. It doesn't change me. Or if it does, it only changes you on that day or the day after, but not very long. I put this question up for you because Jesus was so angry at his disciples. When his disciples asked him, you know, if you read that, it says, what did he say? After he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. It's a parable. Wait a minute. It's not a big story, but it's just saying that these people worship me with their lips, but not with their heart. That's the comparison there. Now listen. You don't have to understand that Jesus, you miss this if you don't understand that the disciples were supposed to know. They were the insiders. Remember back in chapter 4? In fact, he says, are you so dull? Now, wait a minute. Some of you will feel offended if Jesus said that to you, right? Are you so dull? In Tagalog, bobo ka ba? Sakit, ano? Yeah. Why is he saying you're so dull? Don't you see that nothing enters a man from the outside can make him unclean? Now, this is something that's changed. It doesn't say enter through your mouth anymore. It says enter from the outside. When you eat something, where does it go? Comes out again, right? Whether you eat caviar or very expensive food, whatever it is. That you put on Instagram, on Facebook, at the end of the day, it goes into the toilet bowl, doesn't it? That's how dull his disciples are. You're like what's in that toilet bowl. Dull of hearing. Don't you realize? Now look, just to bring this to a bit of a positive side. Jesus says, what comes out of a man is what makes him unclean. For from within, out of the heart of a man, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, etc., etc. By the way, let me just give you why this list, okay? The first part, well, it says evil thoughts, right? But here, immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, those are actions, aren't they? Something you do. Because it doesn't become immorality only if you think about it, but also you do. But the other ones are from the mind. Slander, pride, foolishness, these come from the mind. Right? It makes sense that somehow all of these things that come out from within has to have a source. Pastor, where did we get this evil within us? What is your answer? Sin. S-I-N. Sin. Let me ask you. Does my grandson, Mateo, has sin? I'm about to tell that to my daughter. You see, he's like that because he has sin in his heart. Where does he get that? From his parents, right? And his parents' parents. Oops, that's me. And his parents' parents' parents. All the way to Adam and Eve. You remember this verse? In sin did my mother conceive me. In sin did my mother conceive me. It's part of your genes, your DNA, and mine. Do you accept that? Do you believe that? You're a sinner because you sin, correct? 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 You're a sinner because you sin. Correct? You agree? No. You're wrong. You sin because you're a sinner. You don't become a sinner because you sin. You don't have to become a sinner. You're already a sinner since birth. Original sin. Do you follow? Isn't that so liberating to know? Wait, Pastor, you're treading on dangerous ground. It liberates me from accountability because I sin. I do these things because I'm a sinner. So I have no one else to blame but Adam and Eve. They pass it on to me. That is actually true, you know. Adam and Eve, through them came sin. And because of sin came death. Separation from God. Because sin separates us from God. You are a sinner because of Adam and Eve. All of us are sinners because of Adam and Eve. But what does the Bible say? Praise be to God. Because of Christ, through Christ, what does it say? Came life. Through Adam came sin and death. But through Christ came life and freedom from sin. But as in Adam, all die. But in Christ, all become alive. That's why you need Christ in you. That's why the question that we ask is this. What about environmental factors, Pastor Dodi? Isn't that... I'm meeting some people, the psychologists and those with psychology background in this church after the service, because we're going to talk about something that is in our constitution that we know is important for the life of this church, and that is counseling ministry among lay people. It's not just us pastors who will be counseling. We will have a counseling ministry because we know that this is a problem. Psychologists say that environmental factors affect people. So if you're raised up in a good family, you'll turn out good. Is that true? No. I've seen a lot of families that they raise the children well, but their kids still turn out bad. I've seen a lot of families where the upbringing was bad, but the children turn out good. There is no hard and fast rule that psychologists seem to think. That if you have all these environmental factors in place, then the kids will grow up to be good. No. And why is that? Because of sin. Isn't it? But I have good news for you. Those of you who are trying to raise your children well, does it at least help them to realize that they themselves are sinners in need of God's grace? And so that when they grow up, when their minds are, you know, they think clearly and you know, they have the ability to decide for themselves, they will accept Christ as their Lord and Savior, invite Him into their life, surrender their life so that He can bring about the change. Why? Because the chances of us changing from within is zero. is zero unless God does it. In the same Psalm, in 51:10, the prayer is, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. It's something you don't create for your children or for yourself, because you cannot do it, because you yourself you are a sinner. We are sinners. It's only God who can create it for us, especially the right spirit part, because the right spirit is the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. So how does God change our heart? From within? Through the Holy Spirit's presence, life-giving power in you. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you have no hope. And we add that obeying Him, obeying Christ through His presence in you, in the Holy Spirit, will bring about the foundation of life. Now let me give you a Sunday school lesson again. Bea, you learned the Honor Your Father and Your Mother song. Is there a song for the wise man built his house upon the rock? Wise man built. Remember that song? Is that just a children's rhyme or song? No. It's a verse in the Bible. Where do we find it? In Luke 6, 45-53. Open your Bible, 6, 45-48. This is the only other verse that we will study today, because it has to do with the positive side of it. I don't want to leave you with the negative side, that you're evil within and you're hopeless. You sin because you're a sinner, and that you have no hope of changing, but there is. And Jesus, when He talks in the other Gospels, and listen to this, because a lot of these Sunday school lessons, we get lost in terms of, oh, so that's what a good life is supposed to be. That's how I'm supposed to live if I want to be morally upright and good. No. No, that's not the lesson of that particular part of the Bible. It has to do with Jesus. 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 Every time you read the Bible, anywhere you go, it has to do with Jesus. Not the goody-goody Sunday school lesson where it helps you to be a good person. We aim for our children to be good, but they remember they are sinful. They sin because they are sinners. We aim for our children to be practicing good habits. In fact, many times, not what we do, but what we say. Look at this, Luke 6:45. It's interesting because this is something that comes after what is called the Sermon on the Mount. And Luke 6 calls it blessings and woes. No? Luke 6:45 says, listen to this. No good tree bears bad fruit, nor does a bad tree bear good fruit. Each tree is recognized by its own fruit. People do not dig figs from thorn bushes or grapes from briars. The good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For out of the overflow of his heart, the mouth speaks. Out of the overflow of his heart, the mouth speaks. Some people read this like this, okay? Listen. For out of the bad tree comes bad fruit. Oh, your father is like this. Therefore, that's why you're bad. So, oh, you want to marry this girl? What is his father like or his mother like? Oh no, no, don't marry that girl. Bad fruit from a bad tree. And we have that in our mind already. So somebody wants to court your son or daughter, and you find out about the parents. And then you say, Lord, please don't let this happen. You pray with all your heart, day and night, because a bad tree produces bad fruit. On the other hand, your daughter is being courted by a pastor's son or daughter. Wow. Okay na yan. That's good. Out of the good tree comes good fruit. Wrong. What do we know about us again? We are all evil sinners. Is any one of us a good tree? What's the answer? We're all bad trees. We're all rotten within. We might have nice leaves and lots of fruits, but inside, it's dying and bad. Unless it becomes good, not of itself, but because of the presence of God in that person's life. Amen? So what do you pray for? Do you pray for your children to find a good family? That prayer will never be answered. Because there's no good family. Try this experiment. Get your DNA and see where it comes from. Ancestry.com? I don't believe that. You can always find somebody who can tell you more about your grandparents or great-grandparents. I bet you will find something rotten in the family. Even if they're a long line of pastors. Something is rotten in your family and mine that goes back to generations. Why? Because Jesus said, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the only way for your family to go from rotten to good. Not good because of itself, but because of the presence of God in your family. Look at this. And those of you who think you have bad families now, be comforted. All of us have bad families. If you're ashamed because of what's happened to your husband, your wife, your children, be comforted. All of us are sinners. Not because we sin, but we sin because we are sinners. You know, I think this has to be emphasized over and over again, because the next passages after that bad and good fruit tree is this. The wise and foolish builder. The wise man built his house upon a rock, it says. Why? Because Jesus said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say? 46. 47. I'll show you what he is like who comes to me and hears my word and puts them into practice. What is that person like who puts his words into practice? He's like a man building a house who dug down deep and laid the foundation on rock. When the flood came, the torrent struck that house, but could not shake it because it was well built. But the one who hears my word and does not put them into practice is like a man who builds a house on the ground without foundation, on sand, right? The moment the torrent struck that house, it collapsed. And its destruction was complete. Notice the word complete. It didn't say that destruction began. It was already happening. It's already on the way. All of our lives, our families, our marriages, if something happens to it, the destruction is already there. But it will be completed because you did not build your house upon the rock, and that rock is Jesus. That rock is the presence of Jesus in your life, in your children's life, in your family's life, in this church life. And if we build our foundation and our rock upon Christ, the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Satan cannot do anything about that. In closing, are you willing to be changed from within? From within your heart. We sang earlier, purify my heart. Cleanse me, what? From within. And make it holy. You're not going to make your life holy, no matter how determined you are. I want to be a good example to my kids so that they will follow Christ. I've heard that so many times before, and I've tried that also in the past. It doesn't work. Only God can create a pure heart in you. Only God can make you holy. Only God can make you bear fruit. I sometimes wonder, you know, like when I think about the many times I've tried and failed as a father, whether I could have done better. I struggle with that thought even up to today. When I look at what my children are doing and how my expectations of them being close to God aren't met. And I wonder whether it's fair on them that I expect all of these expectations. And the pressures that parents put on their children. On the other hand, we have parents who, you know, give them, their children, freedom and permission to do any sort of thing. And they too struggle with the thought that perhaps I should have been more strict and set more boundaries. I told somebody that at the end of the day, your children are accountable to God, just like you are. So free from yourself from that guilt, that shame, from that stigma that I have been a bad parent. Either way, being too strict or being too lax. And kids, young people, someday you're going to be a parent too. And you would want to take these lessons to heart because you have to tell your children, I can only do so much for you. You have to depend on God to change you from within. You have to depend on God to give you the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, because you have given your life to Him. That's the promise. And I leave you with that thought. Because it's never good when you see people struggling. And as a pastor, I pray for you and I pray for your struggles that you go through. And I wish I had all the time in the world to attend to each of your needs. And that is why after this service, I'm meeting up with 4 people who will help me to meet those needs, whether the problems are spiritual, emotional, relational, or mental health issues. And it's up to you as a church to support this group of people so that you will see that counseling is so important for you. And remove the shame and the stigma of, I'm coming to them because I have a problem. Who doesn't? All of us do. I have come to some people in this church to express to them my struggles as well. Because the struggle is very real. It's not something you can hide. Because one way or another, those struggles are going to surface. And our purpose is to try and help you before it does. Prevention instead of just a cure. And as a church, we should bear in mind that our aim is so that we can bear fruit. So that God will one day say, well done, faithful servant. It doesn't say successful, sinless servant. Faithful to God. I'd like to invite you to this communion. Does the communion change you from within? Think about that. And as you meditate, I'm going to ask Pastor TJ to play some music of meditation. Does the communion change you from within? It should, you know. Because when you come to the communion, you're coming to the foundation of our faith. To the rock, the solid foundation of Jesus Christ. Of what He did for us, by dying for us. For us who are sinners, not because we sin, but because there's real evil within us. And that evil is because of our rebellion against God. So that every time we perform, or should I say not perform, every time we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we say to God, I've had enough of this evil with me. I repent, and I want what Christ did to take effect in my life. I want His power, life-giving power through His Spirit. I can't do it on my own. I need Christ. So let a man examine himself, the Bible says, and see where his dependence is, both in living an upright life and in getting rid of the evil within. Let a man examine himself and say to God in prayer, Lord, search me. With eyes closed and heads bowed down, if this is the prayer of your heart, you may raise your hand so I can pray for you. And we can pray for each other. Lord, search me. And know my thoughts. See if there's any wicked way in me. Search me from within, Father. Purify my heart. Create in me a clean heart and renew, Father, the presence of your Holy Spirit within me. For on the night our Lord was betrayed, He said to His disciples, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me, for every time you eat this bread, you proclaim the Lord's death. The death of our Lord, which is effective in not only forgiving our sin, but helping us out of the wickedness and evil in our heart. In the same manner, after supper, the breaking the bread, He took the cup and said, this is the new covenant in my blood. This do in remembrance of me. For as often as you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till He comes. This communion is meant to change you and me. Because the remembrance of our Lord's death and what He's done for us should be in our minds every day of the week. rather that we, O Lord, our God, do not condemn ourselves, but instead say to you, there is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. We are yours, and you are ours. There is peace. There is true forgiveness and true joy in knowing Christ. Thank you for that, dear Father. And we pray that you will consecrate these elements so that when we partake of it, and as it goes into our body, we may remember it's not what goes into our body, but from within come evil thoughts and evil actions. And yet, because we are remembering the presence of your Spirit within us, these elements remind us that we have eaten of your flesh and your blood, so to speak, and therefore it permeates our whole being. May that be true for all of us as we celebrate this communion. I pray that, Father, you would open our ears, open our hearts to the wonderful experience we have now. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.